Okay, so a car's gas tank holds 16 gallons of gas and the car gets 24 miles per gallon when driving on the highway. Write expression for the amount of gas left in the tank after driving X miles on the highway. Okay. So a lot of words there, and we gotta kind of figure out something. Okay, so let's start with maybe what units the answer is gonna be in. What units is that gonna be in?
Gallons.
Expression for how many gas is left, so yeah, in gallons. Alright. Well, we put 16 gallons in, and then do we get more gas after that? No, we lose gas. Okay, so we'll start with 16 and go where from there? Minus. 16 minus something. 16 gallons minus some amount of gallons. So we have to use the rest of the information, or part of the rest of the information, to figure out how many gallons get used as we drive along, right? So let's see, we've got X miles, so we're gonna drive X miles, and we get 24 miles per gallon. So if I drove, let's think about it this way, 24 miles, how many gallons did I use?
1 gallon.
1 gallon. How far would I have to go before I use 2 gallons?
48.
So if I went 48 miles, I'd use 2 gallons. How far would I have to go to use 3 gallons?
72.
Did I say 3 gallons or
3 gallons?
3 gallons. Okay, 72. Yes. 24 hours in a day, 3 days, 72 hours. I don't know that one. Okay. Anyway, 72 miles. We would have used 3 gallons. Okay. So what's the relationship between the number of miles and how we get how many gallons that are out of that? Divide by 24. Is that, everybody agree to that?
Yeah.
Is that agreeable? If I drive 1,000 miles and I want to know how many gallons that took, think about 1,000 miles. Well, I would divide it into groups of 24, right? And count the groups of 24. That's what division is. Break it out, that's 24, that's 24, that's 24, and then we just keep breaking it into groups of 24 and count how many groups of 24 there are. That's 1,000 divided by 24, right? So any number of miles that we drive, X, will divide into groups of 24 miles, and each group of 24 miles will represent 1 gallon, be equal to 1 gallon. Here's another way to look at it. Because different approaches are more intuitive to different people. So once I establish that I start at 16 gallons and I'm going to lose a number of gallons, and I'm just trying to figure out how do I take this 24 and this X and turn it from miles, you know, X miles, into gallons. Okay? Well, that's just a conversion thing. We're just going to convert miles to gallons. We're going to have X miles. Right? See, what we're trying to figure out is what is this expression here that we need to put so that I get how many gallons it is and I can subtract from 16. So I'm going to convert miles somehow into gallons. Okay. All we need when we convert between units is some kind of conversion ratio. Have you heard that word, conversion ratio? Okay. So here's an example of a conversion ratio, like 312 yards. No, let's say feet. We want to convert 312 feet to yards. We're going to do that with a conversion ratio. We're going to multiply it by a ratio that's equal to 1. Right, so we're going to put a number of feet and a number of yards. If we know how to convert from feet to yards, how many feet are in yards, or how many yards are in a foot? 3 feet in a yard. Okay. So we know we're going to multiply by some fraction that has 3 feet versus a yard. We're going to do it in such a way that the feet get canceled and the yards get left. So we'll put the feet here, and feet, literally divide feet. That works, okay? Feet divide feet, they cancel each other, and we're left with 3 feet here, we got the 1 yard here.
And then we have
X. What's that?
And then we have X yard.
Well, now we have whatever 312 divided by 3 is, right?
Yeah.
The difference here is we know all the numbers. Here we don't know all the numbers. But we do know I have X miles, and we want to find a way, a conversion ratio, to convert from miles to gallons, hopefully. Is there a conversion ratio to go from miles to gallons? Do we have a miles per gallon ratio?
24 to 1.
24 to 1. We just want to multiply it in such a way, because it doesn't matter if I put it like this or like if I flip it over, it's still like equal to 1, but I want to put it in such a way that the miles will cancel with the miles, and we'll be left with the gallons. So what is it, which is 24 and which is 1?
1 gallon.
1 gallon? 1 gallon, 24 miles.
Yeah.
So the miles are canceling. I get my gallons. Like, why gallons? We don't need to worry about why. Now we can just multiply across. You can kind of forget about the units. We made sure the units work out. So if I do this computation, I'll come out with it right. Multiply straight across. With x times 1 is x. 1 times 24 is 24. So there you go. That way. Or maybe just thinking I drive this many miles and I get 24 miles every gallon divided by 24, that's just intuitive. I just can get that. But if you find yourself struggling between should I take x and divide by 24? Should I take 24 divided by x or should I take 24 times x? You're getting a little confused. Just convert the units. Right? You need some kind of a conversion. And you can do it several times. Like if I had, I had 735 yards, and I wanted to wind up with miles. I don't know about you, but I don't know how many yards are in a mile. But I do know how many feet are in a mile. Do you?
5,280.
So I know how many miles are, or how many feet are in a mile. I also know how many feet are in a yard. So I'll go from yards to feet, and I'll go from feet to miles, because I know those conversion ratios. How many, what's the conversion here? How many yards to how many feet?
1 yard.
1 yard, 3 feet. And we just said 5,280, no, I got that wrong. Feet, 5,280 feet to 1 mile. Once I put all that together, I'll know how many miles I have in 735 yards. 735 times 3 is, and then divided by 5,280, I'll have the number of miles. So you just keep multiplying by conversion ratios, because these conversion ratios are equal to what? What's this equal to? What number is this equal to?
1.
1, right? They're equal. When you divide something by an equal something else, you get 1. This one, 2. That's also equal to 1. Does that help anybody, or does it? Onward then. Are we good? I mean, did that question get answered?
Yeah.
Here we go. 4. All right, so we're doing order of operations here to make sure we do things in the correct order, or the agreed upon order, let's say it that way. So we look at these parentheses, and we ask ourselves about these parentheses. Is there something I can do inside the parentheses, or is there something happening to the parentheses? Nothing I can do inside. Why can't I do anything inside the parentheses? Terms are not like terms. They're unlike terms. They're dissimilar terms, or whatever you may call them. This is an x to the fourth. This is an x. To add those together and into one term is not going to happen. We talked about how. So let's just take x to the fourth plus x. You might want to say x to the fifth. Right? You might want to say that. But then when you think about it, you write it out the long way, you realize that's not correct. Because on this side, we have five x's multiplied together. Here we have an x. Here we have x times x times x times x, but we're adding these together, right? So we can't add an x and have it be the same as multiplying by this fifth x, right? So yeah, not the same thing. So nothing to do inside the parentheses, can't combine them, they're not like terms. Anything happening to the parentheses, like is it being multiplied by something, should we distribute something into there, or is it being raised to a power, or anything like that, right? Sure, distribute 1, right? It is being multiplied by 1, and if we distribute the 1, we'll come out exactly right. Distribute that 1. Done. Okay. Before we distribute that negative, realize that, you know, there's something that results from this parenthesis. There's something that results from this parenthesis, and And those two groups are on the level of being added together. So don't accidentally make it into multiplication. This is the thing we're trying to help you avoid. Okay? Sometimes we'll do everything right here, we'll do everything right here, and then we wind up multiplying what we get with what we get over here. We don't want that to happen. So this is a negative right here. Negative 1 times negative 5x. We're adding 5x. Negative 1 times negative 8, positive 8. Negative 1 times negative 4x to the 4th is positive 4x to the 4th. Combine all the like terms we can find. Here's a like term, these two like terms. So we have a total of 2x to the 4th. 7x and 5x, they're like terms. Right? Just to prove it. 7x is x plus x plus x plus x plus x. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, right? That's 7x. That's what 7x means. 7 times x, x plus itself 7 times. And you know what? I'm going to add the sum of 5 more x's. I'm going to add 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 more x's. We look at all those x's. They're all being added together. We have a total of 12 x's. Put those together, and plus 8. The only number that there is, only constant. Good? Questions? Yes?
Can you just do like 7 plus 5? Like, why all the x's?
Oh, I'm just proving to you that, because I just talked about how x to the 4th plus x can't be equal to x to the 5th, and I just proved it by writing it out long ways. And so I'm just showing you that 7x plus 5x is 12x. Because if we don't realize that this is what's actually happening, then we're relying on rules or like this magic that puts things together in the right way. But if we're ever wondering, like, 7x plus 5x, can I do that? Or does it become x squared? Is it 12x squared? Maybe you get kind of confused about that. No, it's not 12x squared. There's no x times x in here. That's why I write it out long ways. You should be able to answer your own questions at some point, or even better, explain to somebody else. If they say, oh, 7x plus 5x is 12x squared, you should be able to say, no, it's not. And here's why. And the why is not because that's not how it is. Number 12. Plug these guys in for every x that we see. We're going to do what's called evaluating the expression for x equals negative 3 and figure out what comes out for y. And that's all a function is. Learning about functions. A function is just an input-output machine. And remember, my suggestion is before you plug anything in, just put empty sets of parentheses wherever you see an x. And then plug that number in. Yeah.
Got it, too.
But, a 2x squared. Okay, thank you. All right. Now, and it's especially helpful when you have a negative number you plug it in. You make sure that it doesn't wind up, you know, on the outside. It should be. It should be right inside these parentheses. Negative 3 cubed, negative 3 squared, negative 5, negative 3. Negative 3 cubed. That's going to be negative 3 times negative 3 times negative 3. We're sure that we're doing that right because we have the parentheses and the number plugged into the parentheses. So what's negative 3 times negative 3 times negative 3? Positive or negative?
Negative.
We get negative 3 times negative 3 is positive, times another negative 3 is negative. Okay, so we know it's going to be negative. And what's 3 times 3 times 3?
27.
So we get the negative 27. We come over here, we see multiplication, we see exponent. We'll do the exponent first, then we'll multiply by 2. Negative 3 squared, that's negative 3 times negative 3. That's 9. Times 2, we get 18. Negative 5 times negative 3. Positive 15, 6, right? 30, 3, 6, says 0. I got 0 in my head. Negative 2 plus 2 times negative 2 squared minus 5 times negative 2 times 6. Make sure to use my parentheses. Negative 2 times negative 2 times negative 2 is negative 8. Plus negative 2 squared is negative 2 times negative 2, that's positive 4 times positive 2, that's positive 8, they're going to cancel each other out. Negative 5 times negative 2, 10 minus 6, and we get 4. 0, so simple. All the x terms are multiplied to 0, left with negative 6. What do we get to plug into? Zero and 24. The graph is, as I'm trying to make the point very clear, is just a way to represent all the stuff that's in this table and more, infinitely. Okay. But we've got to know something about the inputs and outputs of this function. We've got to ask ourselves that. So we've asked ourselves that 5 different times. We've said, when do we put this in, what do we get out? We did that 5 different times, so we can start to get an idea of what this graph looks like. As far as classifying functions, and these functions when you graph them should look like lines, and these graphs when you, or these functions when you graph their inputs and outputs should look like parabolas, and these ones should look like this, and these ones should look like that. That's for later. We just want to understand the basics. Because the more complex is so much simpler when we know the basics. So negative 3 comma 0. Negative 2 comma 4, 4, 0, negative 6. Just make sure you're being careful not mixing up the x's and y's. 2, 0. And 3, 24 is just 24 so far off the graph that I won't bother. But I do know where the graph should go to, right? Where I should aim the rest of the points. The thing that we're going to do next, the thing that's going to keep you from doing stuff like this, way, way wrong. Think about, this is a function, right? And what happens in between negative 3 and negative 2 is negative a half, or negative 2 and a half, negative 2 and a quarter, negative 2.75, negative 2.99999. I mean, like, all these numbers are going into the function, and we're finding out what the outputs are. So, as I look between negative 3 and negative 2, the outputs that I get, I'm thinking, are somewhere between 0 and 4. That's certainly what it looks like, where they'll land. Can I be sure that there's not some point way up there? Not 100% sure. There could be, right? But I feel like probably not. Probably there's not. More likely, I think, my guess would be, that if I were to plot a bunch of points, I would get a bunch in just straight in between, almost straight. It's kind of curved, right? And now that graph starts to take shape. Faster than drawing lots of points is just drawing a curve that just captures all those points. Now, between here and there, I feel like the points are going to be somewhere between. But if you think of it kind of like the slant of this part of the graph, it makes it difficult to just cut back without making it too pointy. We don't want the graph to be pointy. We'd like to make it as curvy as possible. So maybe there's some more points up here, and then it curves back down like this. That's just kind of my guess where all the points might land. Then points should be in between these guys in some way, so maybe it comes down a little bit, goes up here. That's my guess. In between the points, I think that's about where the rest of the points are going to land. What's going to happen when I get beyond the points that I've grabbed? Well, there's two ways to go about it. Here's as say there's like a level 1 and a level 2. Level 1 would be plot some more points. Plot enough points until you kind of feel like this graph's just going to keep going in this direction. It's going to keep going up or it's going to keep going down. So I could plug in 4 and I could see what I get. I could just go all the way to 10, right? Plug in 10 and see how far that is. If that's really big positive or if that's starting to go negative. Ask yourself, if you put 10 in there, is that going to be big? Big positive number? Yeah? I'm going to add some more positiveness to it, right? Now I'm going to subtract 5 times 10. Think about 5 times 10 versus 10 cubed, which is bigger.
10 cubed.
Which is much, much, much bigger.
10 cubed. 10
cubed is much, much, much bigger than 5 times 10, right? So this is 1,000, and this is just 50. And if we put in a bigger number than 10, we're going to get a bigger number, okay? So just, you know, plug in 10. You're going to get 1,000. plus 10 times 10, that's 100, that's 200. Minus 5 times 10, that's 50. Minus 6, so we're going to get 1,200. Minus 50 is 1,150. Minus 6, 1,144. That's big positive number, yeah. So I'm confident that this graph's just going to need to go. And we actually plugged in 3, right? And got 24. We know it's at least got to get up to 24. And then by the time it gets to 10, it's all the way up to 1,144. So, yeah. If it ever comes back down, that would be really surprising. But based on my investigation by plugging in 10, 3. Then we come the other way. You know, does it go down like this? Or does it maybe come back up and go like that? If I'm not sure, you can just level 1, plug in a number, and see what happens. You can plug in negative, let's do negative 10, because 10 is just kind of easier to multiply things by. Right, negative 10, we're going to cube that. We're going to take 2 times negative 10 squared minus 5 times negative 10 minus 6. Negative 10 times negative 10 times negative 10, is that positive or negative?
Negative.
Negative. So we get this really, really big negative number just by cubing whatever that is that we get. Right. And you start to realize this square thing and this thing that's multiplied by 5, they're not as big as this guy right here. They're, like, their magnitude is not as big as this. Okay. Negative 10 times negative 10 is 100 times 2, that's plus 200. Plus negative 5 times negative 10 is 50 times 6. So you've got negative 1,000 plus 200, that's 800. Negative 800 plus another 50, that's negative 750. Minus 6, negative 756. Not quite as big as 1,144, but it's quite big. So we're pretty sure it's just going to keep going down, 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 forever and never come back up. Okay. Level 2 would be, I don't exactly plug in a specific number, but I do think about what's going to happen as I plug bigger, say, positive x's in, as I move to the right, and I put really big numbers in for x, will it just keep going up? Is there any hope for it ever coming back down?
Well, not really.
Why not?
Because the x cubed plus the x squared
yeah.
is bigger than whatever negative 5x
yeah.
plus 6 will ever be.
By orders of magnitude, it's bigger. But an order of magnitude would be times 10. It's tens and tens and tens and tens and hundreds and thousands of times bigger than this, depending on how big x is. It's many x times bigger. So there's just no hope that it will come back down and we'll start getting smaller numbers than we got before. Right? Not when we put big numbers in for x. What about when we go negative and we put these very large negative numbers in for x? Think it's going to keep going down, or is there any hope for it to come back up? For the same reason that it's just going to keep going up as we go to the right, as we go to the left, stuff like this is going to happen. Put in a negative 100, these are going to be even more different from each other, even farther away from each other. Put in negative 1,000, these are going to be even farther away from each other. These numbers are going to be vary even more in magnitude. Forget about 5 times whatever, that's going to be so small, it's not even going to matter. And subtract 6. 6 can just go home at that point, because it's not making any. So that's like level 2 reasoning. Not just specific examples, but I can convince you for all x's that are bigger than level 2 in this case, it's just going to keep going up. And likewise in the negative direction. Okay, so there's that. Just kind of some next level stuff. But what I'm looking for mainly is just basics like Braxton said, oh, I just grabbed kind of half of the number 11. That's fine. Okay, you just want to let me get the basics. Any other questions from the homework? We should go over. All right, then let's put away, or not put away, but let's pass in the homework. And let's put away everything except for piece of paper, the calculator. If you're not sure how to write this, then then try plugging in things for P, asking yourself, well, if he were to score 12 points, or if he were to score 30 of those points, or if he were to score 57 of those points, then ask yourself, if I knew that number, what would I do with that number to figure out the percentage, okay? So say he did score 12 points, how would you go about figuring out his percentage?
Mitch, so wouldn't you go P over 57 would be equal to like X over 100, which would be a percent?
No. That'd be all right. If that's on there, that's fine. Okay. We don't need it to set up as a proportion. But if you just have this, if you just have P over 57, it's really what I'm looking for. Okay. If you ask me to find your percentage at the drop of a hat, I'm going to take the number that you got right out of the number possible. I'm going to divide them. And then I'm going to multiply by 100, right? Because this is going to give me some number that's less than 1. And it's going to be a decimal, but then we move the decimal over 2 times, okay? If this is there, that's what I'm looking for. If it's equal to x over 100, yes, that's correct. That will, if we solve for x, find the percentage. If you want to be technical about it, though, if you wanted an expression, okay? An expression is not an equation. An expression is just a collection of operations and numbers and stuff. We would, you know, multiply by 100 if we wanted to think about it that way, which would be fine too. So if we have 100 times P over 57, that's fine. If you have P over 57, that's fine. Okay. Just testing you on, do you remember how to find percents, and can you throw it into an expression of some kind? Okay. So you're gonna be kind of lax on that one, either that or if this equals D, or if covered that up, you get P over 57 equals D, that's fine. Got that in it, if it makes sense to you, then that's going to be fine. Because whatever it is, if it's 30, you're going to take 30 divided by 57. It's going to give you some decimal. Right? 30 divided by 57. 0.5, let's run 0.53, 53%. Right? That's how we calculate the percents. If you had 57 out of 57, you scored all the points. 1, move the decimal over 2 times, 100%. Right? Okay, so by following, we're going to distribute, and then we are going to combine like terms. Distribute, combine like terms. Now we got 5 times x and 5 times negative 7, so we get 5x minus 35. Remember, we talked about this from the homework. I'm going to be taking whatever this stuff winds up being, and add those groups together, not multiply, but add. Add what comes next. Negative 3x times x squared. What's that?
Negative 3x cubed.
Nice. Negative 3x cubed. So we're going to add a negative 3x cubed. Negative 3 times 2x.
6x squared.
6x or
negative
6x squared? Negative 6x squared. Yes. Negative 3x times negative 5. It's like an understood and assumed parentheses here, but that's kind of a silly thing to put, right? Because we're just adding this stuff. It's really, I would be distributing a positive 1 in those parentheses, and not wrong, just a little redundant. A little more writing than necessary. So we look at all this, we look for common terms, like terms, put together. Here's the only x cubed around, so I got that one taken care of. Only a single x squared term, so negative 6x squared, that's it. We got 5x with 15x, it's 20x. And the only constant there is negative 35. Try to go at a good pace. If you ever need me to stop and go back, if I go to the next page too quickly, just let me know and I'll back up. No problem with that. In here, remember, my suggestion is that you always replace x's with parentheses, then fill the parentheses with the x, whatever value you're supposed to plug in for x, and then continue. So negative 3. Now it's an order of operations thing. Which thing do we do first? What's first? Exponents. There's an exponent, negative 3 squared. That means because I put the parentheses, where they should be. It got captured the negative inside the parentheses, which means that what I'm squaring is negative 3. I mean, multiplying negative 3 times negative 3, which is positive 9. I can kind of look at this group. Every time you see like kind of a string of multiplication and division, just all in a row, it kind of groups that stuff together, right? Kind of makes that a little block unto itself where we can think about what do we do first, right? So in this group right here, what should we do first?
Multiplication on the left.
Multiplication on the left, right? Left to right. This, then we'll do this, then we'll do this. So first we'll do negative 4 times negative 3, positive 12. We'll just continue to write this stuff just so we don't make any mistakes. All right, we're not going to do 9 plus 12. We're not going to get 21 here because we should divide first. And we should divide before we multiply, because we do that from left to right. So 9 plus 12 divided by 6 is 2. The result of that gets multiplied by 3. Now we have 9 plus 6. And final answer, 15. Continuing on. Unless it stops me.
Can you go back?
I can go back. Complete the table. Complete the table. Once the table is completed, we will have some inputs and outputs that we will translate into points on the Cartesian coordinate plane, and then we'll guess at the rest of the points because we don't have all day. We can't draw all the points there are. So we plug negative 1 in there, and do this kind of speedy 1 plus 3 plus 1, we got 5. 0 is easy, we get 1. One, positive, that would just change this to a negative, so I should get negative 1. Negative 2 there, you got 2 squared minus 3 times 2 is 1. 4 minus 6 is negative 2 plus 1, negative 1. 3 squared minus 3 times 3 is 1. 9 minus 9 is 1, so I get this a 1. If you think that I made a mistake, let me know. I'm not sure about that. So we've got negative 1, 5, 2, 3, 4, 5, negative 1, 5. Careful not to mix up the x's and y's. 0, 1, 1, negative 1, 2, negative 1, 3, positive 1. If I were to guess what happens between these two points, I would guess that my points go almost straight to this point here. And it's going to have to continue on, and all the points between here are going to be there. We're not going to shoot straight across. We're probably going to come below. Okay. Your graphs should be nice and smooth, not pointy. Okay. If they're pointy, you're doing it wrong. Right? You're not thinking about what's happening between these points. What kind of outputs am I getting between these points? Okay. It's going to be very gradual. It's not going to take a sharp turn just because that's the point you happened to choose to plot. If you graphed all the points, there'd be a nice, smooth transition from one point to another. And I think all the points in between here will land somewhere on that curve. So I think it's going to look like that. And we talked about this with that other one, so I won't go into as much detail. But if I keep putting in bigger numbers for x, this x squared is going to wind up being the largest number, with the number with the largest magnitude. Subtracting 3x and adding 1. Going to alter a little bit, but not by all that much. We're going to see numbers that just get bigger and bigger and bigger the bigger we plug in a number for x. Same for negative. When you put negatives in and you square them, you get a positive, right? So the largest number is still going to be positive. All this stuff is going to change it just a bit, but not a whole lot. So the overall output will be some larger positive number as we put in like more and more negative numbers. I do want to see that, like, on a test. I would want to see that you're showing me where the graphs are going. Where's it heading toward? Any questions about any of that? That's the last one. then just tally up the points. Four questions, five apiece, that's 20 points. Score the points. Pass it back to the owner and